there's sort of a local shorthand or a local saying that this bridge is the longest bridge over the shortest body of water in the world. Now, I never have been exactly certain what that means. I think it's more of a cute, funny local saying than an actual claim to fame in the Guinness World Book of Records or something like that. I don't think anybody has ever worked out the mathematics of the ratio of the length of the bridge to the width of the creek and then judged it against other such bridges. But it's kind of a nice, cute, funny bragging point for lack of anything else.
Regina's Albert Street Bridge has a history full of fact and folklore, from stories of its origin, its construction, and its maintenance. Inspired by the discovery of King Tut's tomb in 1922, the architecture features images of papyrus and lotus flowers. Rumor has it that real eucalyptus leaves were put into the cement as part of the tribute. The completion of the bridge was in 1930, in the midst of the Great Depression.
The '30s were tough times. Everybody went through tough times.
Yeah.
That's when this lake was built. They dug it out by hand. They put men to work digging it out. And that's how it got started.
Collectively, the civic, provincial, and federal governments spent nearly $250,000 on the bridge, a staggering sum at the time.
This, in the political history of modern Canada, was quite important because it was part of a wave of projects that went against the flow. Instead of cutting spending in hard times, you spent more in hard times in order to give people employment and salaries. From those, they would buy things, food, furniture, fuel, you name it, and pass along that money to other parts of the economy. As I said, today that kind of cyclical spending is regarded as orthodoxy among economists. But in 1930, when it began, it was pretty radical stuff.
Although there was criticism during its creation, the bridge was treated with fanfare at the grand opening on November 10th, 1930. The construction of the bridge was not the only public works project in its history. Another occurred 40 years later, but much smaller in scale.
And back in the late 70s and early 80s, two families had an annual competition to see who could clean this bridge better and faster. Now, in those days, the way the city streets were plowed, there was a lot of snow, mud, and grunge that piled up against the balusters of the bridge. Two families, the Schumiachers and the Moran family, Joe Moran being the then director of the Wascana Center Authority, assemble all their relatives and friends and would have a competition to see which group could clean their half of the bridge, their side of the bridge, faster. It seems almost a little silly now, but as a kind of enlightened do-it-yourself public works project that made the park a little bit better, you really got to admire something like that.
But there's a dark side to these legends as well. The famous bridge was even once the scene of a grisly murder in the 1960s.
His name was Ivor Holstrom, and an investigation turned up the fact that he was what would now be called a street person, or was then called a wino, and he always hung around with the same guy, with the same buddy. They had been apparently living together for the summer in a crevice, in a small cave underneath this bridge.
The police believe the two men had a fight under the bridge, possibly over liquor. Although the bridge has many stories, good and bad, one story often overlooked is the significance behind the bridge.
But originally it was intended they were going to put plaques up on the bridge to commemorate the soldiers from the First World War. And they never got around to doing that. And they're not up yet, but I guess they won't do it now because they've built a new memorial over in the park there, so they don't have to put them up on the bridge. It would have been nice, but not necessary now.
Well, there are panels on the bridge that are available for plaques, but unfortunately they're either the downstream side or the lakeside, so no one would have ever seen them. And there wasn't enough space anyway. If you used them all, there was not near enough space.
Lloyd Jones was the chairman of the board which built the war memorial, an undertaking that lasted over a decade and was nearly forgotten about.
It was discovered that all of this past history hadn't been completed when the names hadn't been put on the bridge, and that there was still a long outstanding obligation. Yet apparently, I have some literature and some information that says the Minister of Labor at that time said the bridge would never be completed until the names were placed on it. Saskatchewan, for a small population, has suffered a tremendous number of casualties. In the First World War, 41,000 enlisted, and over 5,000 were killed, which is a terribly high rate of casualties. And in the Second World War, the percentage wasn't quite as high, but the number of killed was almost equal.
In the end, the memorial was built beside the legislative building and contains the names of 11,000 soldiers. Although the bridge did not become the memorial it was intended to be, Regina citizens continue to be proud of this notable landmark. It may not legitimately be in any book of records, but for the people of Regina, it continues to be a bridge through history.